Now, the latest jobs numbers from the month of April showed a record number of Filipinos unemployed. That's 17% or 7.3 million people. Now, considering the lag, are these numbers worse than they actually look? Well, the next jobs report, which is for the month of July, won't be out until September. We're going to go ahead and examine the state of jobs in the country from the employer's perspective. ECOP Sergio Ortiz-Luis now joins us live. Hi, sir. Good morning.
Good morning, Angel.
Good morning. So first of all, did you hear anything that you like from the president's speech last Monday?
Oh, yes, I guess the economic measures that he pointed out, many of them we requested create, and of course some of them were not included. But by and large, I think the economic measures was in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned some of the things that you requested were not included. Could you give us an idea what these are?
Among others, we also tried to butt in for some of the issues, but he broke it down. Arise, for instance, was not mentioned, although he did mention that he will part of it is in the agriculture, the 66 billion, the OFW assistance, the TESDA assistance, which are the MSME assistance, corporate assistance for transportation, and I think tourism. Mm-hmm. They were all there. They're part of RISE, but he broke it down. Mm-hmm. I guess the budget, there is still a debate how much really the budget would be put there, I think. So that's why he first included it in a breakdown, but he did not include the total package yet. Mm-hmm.
Siri, I wanted to ask you about the assistance, because you mentioned it. Do you think that government's assistance for affected workers, was that enough? Because if you look at the main points, at least, you have DOLE had a camp, a one-time 5,000 peso cash assistance for workers. You've got DOF with a small business wage subsidy program, which can provide up to 2 months support. That's 5,000 to 8,000 peso assistance. Total number of workers to benefit from those two would be 4.4 million workers. That's a pretty small number if you consider how many Filipinos were affected. What do you think?
Well, that's why we're batting for additional help. No?
And how much more do you want?
Well, I think what was requested, I think, is we're banking on what the DOLE was asking for. No? And we are trying to include also some of the requests that will go to workers and SMEs in the DTI request. Going back to the assistance, there is a lot to be said with the way the assistance was implemented. Mm-hmm. For instance, the camp. We were going on a debate that we were not agreeing on the requirements that they were giving on the camp. And before we were able to agree on a formula, they took away the budget and came in the one of SSS and Department of Finance, no? And we were wondering why take away something that is being already delayed and being distributed, and a lot of people already registered and are waiting for it. And then all of a sudden you introduce another package where there are some issues that are, you know, like for instance, the company must be following all the regulations of BIR, things like those. Well, precisely we are assisting employees, not the companies. Mm-hmm. If you come up with those kind of regulation, a lot of employees were taken out of the equation.
Mm-hmm. Sergio, I want to go back to the jobless numbers. 7.3 million jobless Filipinos in April. As bad as the numbers are, and they're very bad, would you say that they're still understated, that it's actually much worse?
Perhaps let's put things in proper perspective. Mm-hmm. There are 44 million Filipinos in the job market. Mm-hmm. And I think about 17 million of them are in the NCR, Region 3 and Region 4. The rest, basically agriculture, they were not much affected because there was no lockdown in many areas where there are agricultural mm-hmm. producing. But the supply chain was really disrupted, the delivery. When we started initially on the lockdown, I guess the numbers we were talking about was about in the area was basically about 12 million. And then when we went to on the 12 million, there were some exemptions already. Exporters were exempted, although they can only come in 50% of their workers because of a spacing requirement. And food manufacturers and supply and services were exempted. Mm-hmm. So basically, I think when we started the lockdown, about 10 to 20% of those who were locked down were exempted and can work, mm-hmm. but 50%. But then we were hoping that when the MECQ, when we graduated, so many jobs were opened, we were hoping that maybe there would not be 3 million left not being able to work. But, with a lot of problem in implementation, among others, mm-hmm. The transportation. They said that the employers will have to provide shuttle service. But we know very well that 90% of our employers are micro, remember, not small, micro. And they employ about 60% of the people. So if you don't provide transportation, these micro enterprises are not capable of supplying shuttle. Mm-hmm. And the big ones, including the malls, they are able to supply. But how do people get to their pickup point? Because you gotta pick up everybody from the house. Mm-hmm. So they cannot get to the pickup point also because no services were available, bus transportation. So when we graduated GCQ, we thought that they would have looked at this and solved the problem. But then it was worse. Mm-hmm. Until now, people who are expected to work are not being able to work. Because until now, they're debating what will they do with mm-hmm. the ELSA, with the bus, experimenting and what they will do with the jeepneys. We in the business sector were saying the decision or whatever they want to do with the jeepneys, they can be, take the back seat. Let's solve first the pandemic and how to balance the economy. Mm-hmm. And also the one of ELSA. You can all do the experimenting. What we were banking on in ELSA is you do all the infrastructure, all the in ELSA during the while there is no traffic. Now, because there is a problem with the vehicle, and there is a problem of no mass transportation, ELSA is heavy traffic. No schools. 50% of the workers are only working, and yet there is traffic. Why? Everybody tried to bring cars.
Sergio, mm-hmm. clearly. Do you get a sense among employers that the government may be relying too much on private sector to handle it? I mean, you mentioned shuttling employees because of the lack of or poor public transport. There's also government has floated the idea of requiring employers to conduct rapid testing for employees every 2 weeks. Is this even feasible?
What we're saying is when we started, the IATF is driven, I guess, basically by the Department of Health and the ILG, the military. And we have a feeling that the economic managers are not exactly calling the shots. And we can understand why all those problems are coming from, because they don't know about that. They would not talk, for instance, that requiring employers to have testing is not going to work. And even now, they're saying that maybe some employers could do twice a week testing. If the economic managers will be, and the business sector will be consulted, they would tell them it's not possible. And that is why we are saying that during this time, when we are now in the economic recovery system, perhaps the president, he admitted that there were some lapses there, perhaps he should concentrate more now on the economic managers and the some advisors in the business sector and private sector who can help. Because I think this is beyond the ILG and beyond the recovery. And I was glad to read the paper today that the president is saying that, Malacanang is saying that NEDA will be the top honcho in the economic recovery. That is a good news. Mm-hmm. But I just hope that they are really giving the authority to be able to decide what can and what cannot be done. Mm-hmm.
Sir, we don't have much time, so I'm going to very quickly run through this. Going back to the jobs data from April, while 7.3 million Filipinos are jobless, there was another group, and this is perhaps one of the important data points from that report, that 13 million Filipinos actually had jobs but were not going to work. They're hoping that it's temporary, that they can eventually get back to work. And those who are lucky enough to still be employed and still go to work are mostly working fewer hours and getting less paid for it. If you look at from the employer's perspective, Sergio, what you're hearing, what your members are saying, if you look at the next 6 to 12 months, do you think the labor market is going to get worse before it gets better, or this is it?
I think it will get better. The only problem is it's not getting better in the speed that you would like it because of some problems, implementation problems. Among others, the biggest problem was transport. We were hoping that at this time, only about 3 million will be waiting in Metro Manila, but it's more. Some companies opened up even on partial basis, ended up closing again and declaring that they will be permanently closed. I think there were about 3,000 companies that has reported they are closing or downsizing, and about at least on the one closing, I think about 160,000 are already decided permanently closing. Some of them, they did open. But because of the problems that they encountered, they decided it's just going to work. And the biggest one affected, of course, we all know, we don't think that they will be back in 6 months or 1 year time even, is the tourism, the restaurant, and the hotel business.
Hopefully, I heard, Sergio, that there are industries that are hiring, like the contact centers, the BPO. So hopefully they can help absorb some of the displaced workers. Sergio, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for helping put perspective to the numbers.
Thank you very much, Michelle.